Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, Knife Junkie, and welcome to episode number 113 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco. Welcome to the show.
The Knife Junkie Podcast is the place for knife newbies and knife junkies to learn all about knives and knife collecting. Our midweek supplemental show where we dive deep into knife news, talk about some new product drops. We're also going to be talking about knife rights and their ultimate steal, along with the Knife Junkie's Instagram auction and great success there. On Knife Life News, we're going to talk about Kizer as well as Victorinox. Also, Bob's going to dive into his state of the collection, talk about a buoy that he got from Slicey Dicey, as well as the Mini CQC-7 from Tyler at EDC Gear Reviews. Bob's going to go off a little bit about collecting Emerson knives and kind of talk about Tucson knives and promo Thursday night knives and all kind of good stuff. So a lot to talk about again this week, Bob, on the midweek supplemental.
How do we come up with so much to talk about, Jim?
It's pretty easy for you, apparently.
Apparently. Well, first, I want to talk about the ultimate steal. You know, when we're in ultimate steal season, I mention it every show, Knife Rights is responsible for going around the country state by state and helping out-legislate antiquated knife laws. And right now, they're in their fundraising season. They call it the ultimate steal. And by donating, you stand to win any number of great knives that that knife makers, manufacturers, and other people donate to the cause. So depending on how much you give, you know, in these different graduated tiers, you could walk away with an amazing custom knife. So this year, on April 18th, we did the Knife Junkie Town Hall, and we had 18 guests. We were on for 5.5 hours. It was awesome. But two of the guests donated to the town hall. And our friend Stu from Stone and Steel up in New England donated an Emerson Super CQC-7, which is a really cool knife. And then Bob Terzuola himself donated a new copy of his book, the new edition of his book, a beautifully milled logo cap lifter, and a CTF, Compact Tactical Folder, a knife of his design produced by we and distributed by Drop. So that was one package, one lot, the Terzuola lot in this auction. And the Emerson CQC, Super CQC-7 was another lot. So we did an Instagram auction this past Thursday and raised $560 in auctioning those items off. So those 560 U.S. American dollars are going to Knife Rights, you know, in support of the ultimate steal.
Yeah, I thought that was a really cool idea. I thought the Instagram auction went great and wonderful for Knife Rights. I thought the both packages brought very good money.
Yeah, indeed, and I have to pat myself on the back because
pat.
Yeah, because those items were given to the town hall, and you know, in an epic fit of virtue signaling, right there on the broadcast, I said, we're going to auction these off and donate the funds. And then I was like, what did I do? That CQC-7 could be mine. But I think that was the right decision because giving this money to Knife Rights will ensure that I can have and own and carry a CQC-7 in the future. So, boom, there you go.
Well, and it's kind of in the family.
It is in the family. Yes, indeed. The CQ7 is in the family. So all along the day, the Terzuola lot was humming along nicely. And then I got a text from my brother mid-afternoon. He's like, how's the Emerson lot going? And I said, it could use a little boost. What do you say, Vic? Can you put in a bid? And he said, sure. You know, he's got a budding Emerson collection himself. So it's not like he was just doing it as a favor. Like,
didn't take too much
skates.
Nudging, right?
Yeah, right. So he put in the winning winning bid. And I saw his bid go up, and I saw it stay there for a while as the winning bid, and I got back in touch with him. I'm like, Vic, you know, if you win that, I'll buy it from you. And he was kind of like, I didn't just put this bid in to help you, man. I want the knife. So sent off to him and sent the Terzuola lot out to Caleb Townsend, who won. And yeah, $560 heading to Knife Rights.
Well, who knows? Maybe some future knife auctions on the Instagram channel, or maybe some knife auctions or sales or something on Bob's YouTube channel with Thursday Night Knives. Kind of taking a look at that. So if anybody has any suggestions or thoughts, we'd love to hear from you. Call the listener line at 724-466-4487 or shoot Bob an email at bob@theknifejunkie.com if you have any thoughts or suggestions about knife auctions, knife sales, that kind of thing.
Yeah, it would be kind of like the late night knife shows, except with great knives.
So something knife related you want to talk about, movie related,
Yes,
always love these kind of little sidelines.
Yeah. Well, my wife and I watched Extraction last night. It's the new Netflix movie starring Chris Hemsworth, who I'm just going to call Thor from here on out. And he plays, a former Australian Special Forces guy who's a mercenary now. And he goes and he specializes in extracting kidnapped victims. And it's a really great movie, you know.
Action packed.
Oh my gosh, nonstop. Did you see it?
I didn't. I didn't recognize the title, but when you started describing it, yes, I watched it a week or two ago. Yeah, I thought it was a great movie. It's a guy movie. My wife wouldn't like it.
Well, yes, she would, because Chris Hemsworth, Thor, is in it. You know,
my wife wouldn't. But yeah, I enjoyed it.
But he doesn't take off his shirt, ladies. So if you're into watching Thor with an M4 running around shooting people, it's great. But I really like the movie. I like the story good enough, for an action movie. You don't need to go too deep for me. And Chris Hemsworth is actually quite a good actor. There were some scenes that were quite moving when he's talking about his backstory and all that. But the reason I bring this up is that there is a fantastic, well, there are a lot of fantastic fights in this movie, but there's a standout fight in which Chris Hemsworth is fighting with a karambit against a guy who's fighting with a straight bladed knife on the streets of Dhaka, Bangladesh. They've just been fighting on a rooftop and they've fallen off of that rooftop and hit various things on the way down, land on the street, and boy, you know, their pistols are gone. What comes out? Actually, it's a United Cutlery Ronin karambit that he has, if I'm not mistaken, which I thought was an interesting choice. I could see why they would use that as movie makers, because it's flashy and, it's got a big bright silver ring and a big bright shiny curvy blade, and you can see it well, but it's probably not the knife he would carry in real life if you're going to be a nerd about it. But anyway, so it's Chris Hemsworth or Thor with this karambit fighting a Bangladeshi former special forces guy who is now the henchman for a drug lord, and it is a great fight. And we slowed it down a little bit. I saw a couple of moves that Chris Hemsworth does with the karambit that I remember being taught. I never really got too deep into karambit, but it was really fun to see, and something that's somewhat unusual. Another karambit fight I can remember is in that movie Taken with Liam Neeson on the yacht at the end.
Great movie too.
Yeah, great movie, great fight, and both of these movies, you can tell, are the fights are choreographed by people who are trained in the real deal and definitely Southeast Asian kind of martial arts. And it's just great to see. I love it. So if you're all at home and you have Netflix, check out Extraction with Thor. Mm-hmm. It's a great movie. And, it's what you want out of this kind of thing. Doesn't give you too much emotion, just enough to care about the character. And it gives you a lot of action.
Yeah, just a lot of those things in that movie, you could have just written me off, you know. And then when you throw me I fall off a balcony onto the street, I'm out, man. Just, I give up. Here, take the kid.
Yeah. Well, I thought the worst part was ducking into the sewer. I was like, oh man.
Yes. If you, yes.
Mm. Spoiler alert, they go in the sewer.
Yeah, I almost threw up on that one. But yeah, great movie. Definitely recommend it, and not only for the movie, but as you said, the weapons and the knives.
Yeah, the spectacular knife fight. Yeah.
Great stuff. All right.
Subscribe to the Knife Junkie's YouTube channel at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube.
Hey, want to remind you that a great way to support the Knife Junkie podcast, if you are a fan of our shows, is to get the Get Upside app. It's a great way to get cash back on your gas purchases. Get Upside, again, is an app you have on your smartphone. Whenever you need gas, you can search your area to find out which stations are giving you savings. Just claim that discount, fill up your tank, and then when you're done, take a picture of the receipt. It's as easy as that. You've just earned cash back. So get the app, theknifejunkie.com/saveongas. Start saving on gas today. Go to theknifejunkie.com/saveongas.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. And now here's the Knife Junkie with the Knife Life News.
I just saw an article in Knife News that Kizer Knives out of China is having a design contest for customers. So anyone who wants to, or for the wider public, design a Kizer patch, you know, like a patch that you put on your tactical bag, or a small pocket tool. You can do that for Kizer. Now, a small pocket tool, I mean, like one of those mini pry bar things with the cap lifters and the screwdriver, etc. So you can either design a patch for Kizer or a small pocket tool and be entered in this design contest. And the winner, their product will be produced and distributed by Kizer, which I think is a pretty cool thing.
Yeah, really cool.
However, I have to say, you should not be in it for the royalties, all right? Because if you win, you get the product that they are producing. So if you make the patch, they'll give you a patch. And you get a Vanguard knife, which is their low-end knife. Or if you make the pocket tool and they decide to make that, well, they'll give you one of those pocket tools and a Vanguard knife. So, you know, you better be in it for the design challenge and the sheer thrill of seeing them mass produce this pocket tool and sell it to a bunch of people.
Bragging rights, really.
That's bragging rights, purely.
Well, it'd be especially great for new designers or someone who hasn't yet had a knife design produced or whatever, actually, as you said, earn their chops, get some cred, and you know, get their name.
Exactly. And I'm glad you mentioned it like that, because you really do have to be a designer to do this. You can't just jot it down on a cocktail napkin, which is what I initially did. And then I read further and I saw, oh, you actually have to send them CAD files. So really, you know, go to the Kizer website and check out all of the stipulations. But they are taking this seriously. You can't just like scrawl something off and send it to them. So it will be interesting to see what comes out of it. Oh, God, I don't know. I guess it must be me. But I read that. I was like, you should get something more than just that. If they start making it, like, they should send you 10% of every. And then I was like, don't be real, man.
All right.
So you're right. That is exactly. It's the bragging rights.
Right.
It's like working on movies for free, which I did for a long time so I could get credits, you know?
So I'm sure with 113 episodes of the Knife Junkie podcast, you perhaps know somebody who can do CAD. Do you think the Knife Junkie and DeMarco Knife and Tool would have a napkin sketch that could get a CAD file and turn in for the contest?
Interesting. Can you edit out all of my cynical bloviations? That's actually a good idea.
Well, I'm the great idea guy of this podcast.
You are. I'm the mouth.
That's right. We'll bloviate in a little bit. But hey, if you're interested, Kizer Customer Design Contest sounds pretty interesting. Lots of rules and regulations, stipulations. So we'll have the link on our show notes page so you can read more about it. But who knows, maybe something there for you. Victorinox, again, a company that we've talked about, seems like a couple of times, maybe two, maybe three times here on the Knife Junkie podcast. Not a lot, but some new news here to talk about their Farmer model.
So we don't talk about Victorinox too much here. We mention it more when I'm in a slip joint phase. We talked about it a lot when we first started the podcast because of your tinker, your everyday carry. Mm-hmm. But I have always been a real sucker for their ALOX models, their aluminum handled models, and they treat them kind of like their sprint runs in a way. They come out with a new color every year for their Pioneer ALOX and their Farmer ALOX. But they, in the past few years, have been doing something that I really love. They've been creating what they call the X model in the ALOX line, and the X model is it's visually onomatopoetic, if you will. The X is supposed to look like the X of the scissors. When you open up the scissor tool on the Victorinox, they kind of look like an X. So they are adding scissors to popular models throughout the ALOX line and calling them the X model. And so they're doing a Farmer model, which is a which the traditional tool set is an awesome saw. I love the Farmer because of the saw, which cuts through rattan great, like rattan collie sticks. It also has a great awl on it and a cap lifter screwdriver thing, the can opener and the blade. And now they're adding scissors to that tool set, which to me is amazing. And it's all in the Alox and in that aluminum body, which is so pleasing to me. Now, the only thing I wish they would do is figure out how to get that awesome toothpick and tweezers into the Alox handles, because that's the only thing that stops me from going Alox crazy. Because I would definitely, I think I might get this Farmer X model anyway, just because it has all the tools I love, except for the toothpick. Yeah. So I wish they'd just figure that out. And you can use the blade or the awl as the toothpick if you want to look
gross.
It look kind of like an animal doing that, but it,
That's definitely my favorite feature of my my little Swiss Army knives that I have in the car and desk and pocket and all that is the toothpick. I honestly use the toothpick more than the knife.
Yeah. You know, you brought up something funny. You and I were out to lunch once, and I mentioned that I had seen a Victorinox that you might like on Blade Forums to buy, and you were like, "Yeah, but what am I going to do with that toothpick?" And that never occurred to me. But you know, you can go on Amazon and buy Blade HQ and buy replacement tweezers and replacement toothpicks. They come in five sets of five, actually. So you know, if you buy a used Swiss Army knife, you're not damned to use that used toothpick.
Yeah, definitely, definitely a must buy if you buy a used Victorinox. Absolutely.
And now that we're caught up with Knife Life News, let's hear more of the Knife Junkie podcast.
All right. Good stories there in Knife Life News. If you have thoughts about any of these, we'd love to hear from you. Again, call the listener line at 724-466-4487. Shoot Bob an email at bob@thenifejunkie.com. Or if you have any stories or things that you've seen in knife news that you want us to cover here on the podcast, again, call the Knife Junkies listener line at 724-466-4487 or shoot Bob an email at bob@thenifejunkie.com. All right, now is our portion of the show where Bob gets to talk knives in depth, kind of almost an audio knife review or his thoughts or whatever. But we're going to talk a lot about Emerson knives, something that's near and dear to your heart, Bob.
Well, I just wanted to talk about the two incoming I have and then mention a little bit about Emerson.
The two incoming Emersons I have. Oh, poor you.
Okay. Yeah, the first one is the Emerson Appalachian. It's a beautiful folding bowie by Emerson. And Slicey Dicey had bought it, did a review of it, and I knew right away that, he mentioned right away, like, this is not my thing, but people want to see it, and my first impression of Emerson from years back was not good, and so I wanted to get a new Emerson, see what's up. So he got it, and loved the blade, and to him, it was a great improvement over former knives, but it's just not in his, you know, he knew he wasn't going to carry it, it's not his jam, so, he very shrewdly sent me an email saying something to the effect of, "Do you want my Appalachian?" And I sent him an email back saying something to the effect of yes. And, he gave me a good price on it and everything. And it should be here tomorrow. I'm very much looking forward to it because it will now be the third Emerson Bowie that I have. And Ernest Emerson obviously has a soft spot in his heart for the Bowie shape because he has many different models with the clip point blade on it. But the 13 is my favorite. And then the Iron Dragon is a close second. And it looks like this Appalachian is going to be right up there with the 13. Just something about that clip point shape that is so compelling to me. But I've also really recently come to really appreciate the chisel edge, not just a chisel grind, because not all Emersons have a chisel ground blade, where one side is completely flat and then the bevel is on the other side. Some of them are V-ground right up to the edge and then chisel edge. And really, I mean, I came to appreciate it more just from making knives in my backyard with my rudimentary tool set that I can get knives when I'm making them so much sharper when I do it like a chisel edge. And so when just through personal experience, I started to appreciate that kind of edge more. And now I've had this resurgence of interest in Emerson. I mean, it happens. I'm cyclical with everything, and I'm back in an Emerson cycle. So I'm very excited to see that. But I'm also very excited. EDC Gear Reviews on YouTube, Tyler, I've been watching him for years. I really like his videos, and he recently did a sales video, which he does every now and again, and he had a Mini CQC-7, so a tiny version of the large knife that we auctioned off this past week. And it is a 100% chisel edge, a chisel ground blade with a chisel edge, and it's little, and it just, and he had it up for a great price. I snatched that up. I'm really looking forward to that too, Jim, because the chisel Tanto seems to be the most basic, like closest modern knife back to the caveman knife.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. But something about it, you can't put it in words. Something about it you like, you love.
It's true. And so this is where the bloviating begins, because Jim, I have a car analogy, and I'm not big on analogies, especially not sports analogies but this is a good car analogy, I think, for the Emersons. And it just occurred to me that I love, you know, the idea of like a Tesla or a Lamborghini, like or a McLaren or some really like high-end, highly tuned sports car. But and if I had a collection of sports cars, I would have a few there. But I think I'm really more drawn in my older age. You know, when I was younger, I really went for, like, I thought, oh, by the time I'm 25, I'll be driving a Ferrari and I'll have a Lamborghini as secondary car. But now that I'm more than an adult, I guess, you know, in my advancing age, I'm more compelled by muscle cars and by old cranky Porsche 911s and cars that... and this is in my ideal. I don't drive any of these things. I don't know if it's a pain in the ass to drive around in a cranky old 911, but I'm more compelled by that, or an AC Cobra or some cool old. And to me, you know, warts and all, transmission and heavy clutch and all that stuff and all. And then when I pick up an Emerson, it kind of reminds me of one of those kind of cars, a cranky old 911 or a muscle car or something, because it's not perfect, and it's not brought up to the latest in technology or the latest in trends in the engineering for that particular product. It is something that works, and it works in a high performance way, but it is not overly polished.
Hmm.
You look at it
overly showy?
Yeah, or overly showy, exactly. You can see the machine marks, you can see the humanity that went into creating it. It wasn't something that was, you know, deposited perfectly. It takes a little breaking in. You get an Emerson, you gotta work through it when you get it, and I know that really sticks in a lot of craws, and it has in mine in the past. I've said it many times on this show and in videos, like, why can't you just send it to me broken in? But there's something about breaking it in and then having it break into you that seems like a fountain pen. If anyone likes fountain pens, you never let anyone else write with your fountain pen, because the nib takes on the angle of how you write. It's the same thing with an Emerson. It's the same thing with a cranky old car. And I think that's part of what I miss from these perfectly executed Chinese blades, you know, like the Riats, for instance. I have two of them and I love them greatly. They're awesome knives. I respect them highly, but there's just a tiny bit of something that's missing. Maybe it's that cranky soul. Yeah.
Well, to use your car analogy, breaking in your car, breaking in your knife, you break in the front seat, the driver's seat. It fits you, you know? So the knife kind of becomes part of your hand, and it fits in your hand, and you break it into your hand, and opening and closing, you get the feel for it. So, yeah, I understand.
Yeah, yeah. And in a way, you're also breaking yourself into it. You know, you receive a perfectly tuned knife from Riat, and that's awesome. And I'm not complaining about that. But you receive something that you have to break in, you finally break it in, and it breaks into you, and you break into it, and there's sort of that. Well, you know, it's
magical.
Like, it's sort of like an avatar when you capture your own dragon, and you. Okay, I'm going to stop right there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let's stop and move on, and we'll talk about Thursday Night Knives on Bob's YouTube channel, theknifejunkie.com/YouTube, theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Thursday Night Knives is the live video show every Thursday night at 10 p.m. A lot of guest co-host on weekly, viewers jumping in and talking weekly. So we're certainly hoping that you can join us this Thursday, May 21st, for the Knife Junkies Thursday Night Knives. And a special guest co-host this week, Neves Knives, are going to be back with you. But that's also right. Neves has given you some two-son knives that you're going to be talking about with Jared and Kara.
Yeah, I mean, talking. We were just talking about perfectly engineered knives. These two-son knives, they sent me four very generously, and I said I'd keep them for a week. At the end of the week, I'll make a video, and then I'd love to bring you guys on and talk about them. And man alive, these knives are suspiciously awesome. And when I say suspiciously awesome, I just mean...
Surprisingly?
Surprisingly, yeah. And from what I know about this company, which is very little, they have 8 trillion different designs, and you can only find one of each. Hmm. And they go up on you get them on eBay, and it's very mysterious. That's why I say suspiciously. It's sort of like I mentioned this last week on Thursday Night Knives. It reminds me of Trader Joe's food. It's like it's a little bit too good. And why is it not? In any case, these things, I'm excited to talk to them about it because they are highly tuned knives. The materials, you know, I'm not a big carbon fiber fan. They have really incredible carbon fiber on these models. The milling is really high end. I mean, we're talking tiny little herringbone patterns and stuff in action beyond belief, and some materials that are, you know, one of these knives has M390, the rest of them are D2, but these design, one of them is a Tepi design. I don't know who these guys are or who they think they are or what they're doing, but they're making some amazing knives. So I'm interested to talk to Neves about them and find out what they know about them because I am impressed.
Well, sounds like a future guest if they would be willing to come on the Knife Junkie podcast and talk.
You know what? I think there are some other bridges to cross before they're coming on podcast because, like, I haven't been able to find much about them. Let me do a little bit more research.
All right, figure out who they are.
Yeah.
All right, so Two-Son Knives with Jared and Kara Neves of Neves Knives. That's on tomorrow nights. That's the May 21st edition of Thursday Night Knives. If you're listening to this podcast the day it comes out, if you're listening after May 21st, well, the Thursday Night Knives is archived on the Knife Junkie's YouTube channel that you can find at thenifejunkie.com/YouTube. So if you don't get a chance to see it live, you can definitely watch it in the archive. So looking forward to that. Again, Thursday Night Knives every Thursday night at 10 p.m. And while we're promoting stuff or mentioning stuff coming up, next Sunday's podcast, or this coming Sunday's podcast, May 24th, is going to be Everyday City Carry.
Yes, Everyday. We spoke to Ray from Everyday City Carry. What an awesome guy. He's got a great podcast and a great channel on YouTube that's just shooting up. He does great reviews and of knives, great unboxings, and then he does really great interview podcasts with other YouTubers, and he is funny, man. He's got the gift of gab. He's hilarious and insightful and smart. You know, he's not just making jokes. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to hearing the finished podcast.
Well, we're going to remind or thank again. I think we did at the beginning, but definitely want to thank again Bob Terzuola and our buddy Stu from Stone and Steel for the donations to the Knife Junkies YouTube channel that Bob auctioned off on his Instagram. That's at thenifejunkie.com/Instagram, with all proceeds benefiting Knife Rights. And of course, the auction and the proceeds going to Knife Rights would not have been possible without the donation from Stu and Bob Terzuola. So again, big, huge thank you to those gentlemen for the donations that help lead to the funds for Knife Rights.
And thank you, Caleb and Vic, for bidding and winning.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, Bob, final word as we wrap up this supplemental episode of the Knife Junkie podcast.
Chisel grind. I think the next knife fight we have will be chisel grind versus V grind.
Oh, there you go. You heard it here first on the midweek supplemental podcast, folks. Episode number 113 of the Knife Junkie podcast. Thank you so much for joining. If you could do us a favor, share this podcast with one friend sometime this week, whether it be an email, a Facebook post, something on YouTube, a tweet, face-to-face interaction, whatever. let somebody know that loves knives know about the Knife Junkie podcast. We would certainly appreciate your support. For Bob, the Knife Junkie DeMarco, I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person, saying thanks for joining us on the Knife Junkie podcast.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.